A very good morning to one and all present here. I, Nikita Chandak.
I, Purva Shinde. I here to welcome you all to the 5th Foundation Day celebration of our Dr. Manu.V.L.Kothari, Chair of Medical Humanities.
4 years ago, on this very day, a chair was established in the fond memory of Dr. Manu.V.L.Kothari. Then the Manu.V.L.Kothari chair and division has been striving hard to inculcate the Manu.Kothari SERS philosophy and values into budding doctors. We would now like to show you all a short clip on Dr. Manu.Kothari SERS life and what all the Manu.Kothari chair and division of medical humanities strives for.
It is a remarkable thing that you have done to set up a Department of Humanities. I would prefer to call it Humanities rather than Medical Humanities. It is really a very important aspect which has been missed out in not only this city, in our country. My proposition today is that the awareness and particularly an acquaintance, if not a deep study of the humanities, makes a better physician. And what exactly do we mean by humanities? Well, it includes history, it includes ethics, it includes literature, poetry, philosophy, religion, perhaps social sciences, art and culture, the visual arts, poetry, drama, and even cinema.
It's people like you, late Professor Manu.Kothari. As you all know, he taught subject which we usually associate with cadavers. But such a deadly subject, but he made it the subject as well as the students with whom he related, he made the whole relationship so alive, so passionate, so divine. And throughout his life, through his passionate interactions with students, through his very unorthodox ideas, viewpoints which were not very highly welcome in the medical established fraternity, and he continued to, I suppose he continued to tease students' brains to think different.
Otherwise, any girl who has studied in a municipal school, who didn't have any confidence, I would learn to take these challenges. I don't think GS, getting into GS Medical College was my, still I believe, was my biggest achievement.
I would now like to call upon two of our students, Ishwari Lele and Vanshika Chidela, to sing a short Ganesh Vandana for us.
गणनायकाय गणदैवताय गणाध्यक्षाय धीमहि गुणशरीराय गुणमन्दिताय गुणेशानाय धीमहि गुणाधीताय गुणाधीशाय गुणप्रविष्टाय धीमहि एकदन्ताय वक्रतुण्डाय गौरीतनयाय धीमहि गजेशानाय भालचन्द्राय श्रीगणेशाय धीमहि एकदन्ताय वक्रतुण्डाय गौरीतनयाय धीमहि गजेशानाय भालचन्द्राय श्रीगणेशाय धीमहि गानचतुराय गानप्राणाय गानान्तरात्मने गानोत्सुकाय गानमत्ताय गानोत्सुकमनसे गुरुपूजिताय गुरुदैवताय गुरुकुलस्थायिने गुरुविक्रमाय गुह्यप्रवराय गुरवे गुणगुरवे गुरुदैत्यकलक्षेत्रे गुरुधर्मसदाराध्याय गुरुपुत्रपरित्रात्रे गुरुपाखण्डखण्डकाय गीतसाराय गीततत्त्वाय गीतगोत्राय धीमहि गूढगुल्फाय गन्धमत्ताय गोजयप्रदाय धीमहि गुणातीताय गुणाधीशाय गुणप्रविष्टाय धीमहि एकदन्ताय वक्रतुण्डाय गौरीतनयाय धीमहि गजेशानाय भालचन्द्राय श्रीगणेशाय धीमहि एकदन्ताय वक्रतुण्डाय गौरीतनयाय धीमहि गजेशानाय भालचन्द्राय श्रीगणेशाय धीमहि ग्रन्थगीताय ग्रन्थगेयाय ग्रन्थातरात्मने गीतलीनाय गीताश्रयाय गीतवाद्यपटवे ध्येयचरिताय गायगवराय गान्धर्वप्रियकृपे गायकाधीनविग्रहाय गङ्गाजलप्रणयवते गौरीस्तनमधनाय गौरीहृदयनन्दनाय गौरभानुसुताय गौरीगणेश्वराय गौरीभ्रमणाय गौरीप्रवणाय गौरभावाय धीमहि गोसहस्राय गोवर्धनाय गोपगोपाय धीमहि गुणाधीताय गुणाधीशाय गुणप्रविष्टाय धीमहि ekadantay vakratundaay gauri tanayaay dhimahi gajeshanaay bhalachandraay shri ganeshaay dhimahi ekadantay vakratundaay gauri tanayaay dhimahi गजेशानाय भालचंद्राय श्री गणेशाय धीमहि
थैंक यू ईश्वरी एंड वंशिका. It is indeed a matter of great honor for us to have all these dignitaries to join us for the event today.
We would now like to welcome our resource person for today, Mr. P. Sainath sir. I request Dhruv to welcome sir with seed balls as a small token of appreciation. In a bid to go eco-friendly, our Department of Medical Humanities has taken the initiative to welcome the guests with seed balls in place of the conventional flower bouquets. A seed ball consists of plant seeds at the core, surrounded with soil and fertilizers, and all one needs to do is to put the ball in ground, and this serves as planting a new tree.
Our next guest for today is Dr. Sunil Pandya sir, who is not only well renowned neurosurgeon but also serves as the chairman of the Dr. MUMBAI Chair of Medical Humanities. Dhruv, please welcome sir.
We are also privileged to have Dr. Manu Kothari sir's daughter-in-law, Dr. Meenal Kothari ma'am, along with us today. We welcome you, ma'am. We would now like to introduce our keynote speaker for the day, Mr. P. Sainath sir. He is a well-renowned journalist and influential public speaker, author and teacher. Sir worked as the rural affairs editor at The Hindu for a long time up to 2014, after which he founded PARI, that is People's Archive for Rural India, which is a countrywide platform for digital journalism.
Sir has been working hard and has dedicated his entire life to throw light on some of the highly ignored issues of rural India, like agrarian crisis, farmer suicides, water scarcity, and the striking cultural and social inequality that these people face. He is well known for his book, Everybody Loves a Good Drought, that is regarded as one of the most authentic and highly regarded studies of modern India.
Sir has been honored with numerous national and international awards, including the Raymond Magsaysay Award, that is Asia's most prestigious civilian award, PUCL Human Rights Journalism Award, and Raja Lakshmi Award, to name a few. Two documentary films based on his work, Nero's Guest and A Tribe of His Own, have received over 20 awards across the globe. We are truly privileged to have you amongst us today, sir. We thank you from the bottom of our hearts. We are all well aware that inequality exists in our country at various fronts. However, we as city dwellers often fail to realize the immense dimensions that this problem can have. Healthcare has been one of these sectors to bear the brunt of this inequality and the rising rich-poor and urban-rural gap in our country. Today, sir will be talking to us about how and why inequality is unhealthy and how economic policy exacerbates the rising inequality in our country. We welcome you on the dais, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm honored to be invited to deliver the Manu Kothari Memorial Lecture. It's barely 72 hours to Republic Day, foundation day of your republic. some 72 days before Republic Day, you had a speech on inequality made, I think remains the most powerful speech on inequality, made on the floor of the Constituent Assembly as Dr. Ambedkar handed over the draft constitution to the Constituent Assembly. Among the many things he said were a few lines. This was on November 25th, 1949. They had finished the draft, they were handing it over to the Constituent Assembly. Some excerpts from that speech. On the 26th of January 1950, we are going to enter into a life of contradictions. In politics, we will have equality, and in social and economic life, we will have inequality. How long shall we continue to live this life of contradictions? How long shall we continue to deny equality in our social and economic life? If we continue to deny it for long, we will do so only by putting our political democracy in peril. We must remove this contradiction at the earliest possible moment, or else those who suffer from inequality will blow up the structure of political democracy that this assembly has so assiduously built up. And from there you get one of those principles, a social order in which justice, social, economic, and political shall inform all the institutions of national life. I think that speech and the points he made about democracy in politics and being threatened by the lack of it, by the lack of equality in social and economic life, truer words were never spoken, and that's where you are today. It defines the situation we are today, with that edifice of your democracy under serious threat. Inequality in India is greater than it has ever been since maybe the 1920s. But a country, you know, the way we fight it, and one of the things we need to look at is this country has a great skill for demolishing major problems by redefining them. You know, we solve our housing problem by redefining what a house is. You bring down the number of people below the poverty line by redefining what poverty is, or calorific norms, or whatever you want to do. You redefine that. I'm happy to say that we in Maharashtra are the pioneers of this. I want to show how many, you know, I don't know what problems we're talking about hunger and nutrition and stuff. Maharashtra in 1963 legally abolished the word famine. It passed an act in the legislature. Here you are. It's called, the Maharashtra deletion of the term famine. Do you see it? The Maharashtra deletion of the term famine from laws applicable to the state. And it went on to say that henceforth the word famine will be removed from all laws in Maharashtra. By the way, a few years ago we took a step further, we dropped the word drought from most documents. We replaced it with water scarcity. Okay? You can end this problem simply by redefining it. Yeah? You were the pioneers, by the way, okay? 1963 that act is passed, to the best of my knowledge, unanimously in the assembly. Now there was a context and a history why that act came. It was a nation 15 years away from major famines, and famine had a terrible impact on the public mind. So I can understand that they wanted just to get rid of that word, but they also set a trend in kidding yourselves about where you are, in fooling ourselves about where we are. If you look at, say, we've done this in, we keep redefining things, okay? I think you've done that in the NSS 71st round, which is the fourth of the health rounds that I'm aware of after 40th, 52nd, 60th, and now 71st round. We've changed the definition, for instance, of what medical treatment means. In the earlier surveys, medical treatment meant treatment undertaken on the advice of a medical person. In the 71st survey, that is removed. The prescription you take from the chemist at the shop, the pharmacist giving you advice across the counter, all that now constitutes medical treatment. So obviously, it will reflect a huge expansion in medical treatment. I'm not saying you shouldn't do it. I'm saying that it's been done and it has great implications for your data. That it does. There's no question about it. So you've redefined what is medical treatment. It includes, by the way, self-medication, everything else. It also redefines expenditure incurred to mean collected with a paid approach rather than, you know, what happens. It actually leaves out things like, I mean, theoretically it excludes things like cashless payment, where there is no direct payment from the pockets of the consumer or the client, whoever. But this is also the language of inequality. You know, we are not prepared to do those things that you have to do to solve or address the crisis of health. It's not as if we are heading for a crisis. We have been there for quite a while now. We're not prepared to change that because inequality produces its own mindset, its own language, its own perspective of the world. Let me give you some things on the kind of inequality that has sprung up, okay, in the last 25 years. One, there is a dramatic increase in wage inequality. Stunning increase in wage inequality. The income share of the top 1% has increased substantially. The bottom 50% is a different story altogether. Now, let me show you the figures brought out by, this is the wealth and minimum share deciles of the 10 different deciles in 138 countries across the world, annually put out in a report by a famous multinational bank, Credit Suisse. It's called the Global Wealth Data Book. Now, this is not the journal of a radical left-wing party. It's a multinational bank calculating wealth and, you know, disparity in the world. Please notice that every year, look at India, for instance, the bottom 1%, the bottom 10%, the bottom decile, its wealth is now negative at minus 0.9. How do you have negative wealth? It means that your liabilities far outstrip your assets. It means that a gigantic percentage of your population, a gigantic number of people rather, are severely sinking in debt. Okay? Now, if you look at the, and mind you, a very substantial part of that is debt incurred through health expenditure. Health expenditures are the fastest or second fastest route to rural family debt in this country. just health expenditure. In the, I will come to the farmer suicide households and what their health expenditures were. But let me also show you much earlier stuff as well. Have a look. In 2015, how you see, it's not as if the cake expanded and there was a bigger share for everybody. It wasn't so at all. The top 10% ate the cake from bottom up. You can see a clear transfer of wealth, a clear transfer of wealth towards the top from bottom to top. Please look at 2015 report. In 2015, you're looking at a bottom 10%, which actually owns 0.1% of house. This is total household wealth. The bottom 10% of your population actually owned 0.1%. The next decile owned 0.4%. The third decile, 0.7%. And the fourth decile, the fifth decile, fourth 1.2 and the fifth 1.7. Now, have a look at what has happened to them by 2018. By 2018, that bottom 10% which owned 0.1%, where is it at now? It's at minus 0.8%. It's at minus 0.8%. The second decile is at 0.2%. And the third is at 0.6%. In other words, the bottom 30% of your population own zero. Bottom 30% of your population, its assets, its household wealth, share of household wealth is zero, because 0.2, 0.6 set off by minus 0.8. The next year, on 2019, the bottom 10% is at 0.9%, minus 0.9%. So you're seeing a steady sinking of the share of the bottom 30%, bottom 40%. If you look at, say, the bottom 50% here, you're looking at something like 2.8% of the total wealth of the share household wealth. The bottom 50% has 2.8%, and that's it. Now look at the top 5%, look at the top 1% in the same line. Top is 42.5%. That is one of the worst rates in the world. The top 1%, 42.5. Let's say you looked at the United States. Classically unequal society, 35.4%. So the share, the top 1% in the Indian population own a greater share of total household wealth in their society than the top 1% of the United States in America. And it is nobody disputes the fact that the United States is more unequal than it has ever been since 1929 and the Great Depression. Nobody disputes that. Okay? So you have managed in a short period. The Americans embarked on this journey from the 1973 after the oil shock. Yeah? Falling wages, real wages of workers, etc. We have done this, compressed this in 25 years, 28 years of neoliberalism, of economic policies that essentially enrich the top 1%. Okay? So that is essentially the journey that we have undertaken. Just look at, I mean, the country after country and look at where we are. In fact, the 2019 report does some minor changes in calculation. You will find otherwise that it was 51.5% in the 2018 report. So you're looking at fantastic inequality in those directions. Let's look at it in other terms before we come to the social differences. Look at it in other terms. What do we find? In year 1991, the year we embarked on our brave new world of reform, there was not a single dollar billionaire in India. You can check that with Forbes, my favorite website. You know, Forbes every year puts out a list on March 8th. Billionaires in the world, country-wise. For some curious reason, they put out their billionaires list on International Women's Day. There are actually very few women account for a very small, maybe it's an aspirational thing, so. So in 1991, you had zero billionaires. Then we embark on our activity. By year 2000, you've still made modest progress. In year 2000, we had eight dollar billionaires. We're talking about dollar billionaires here, yeah, real money. By year 2012, which is the year we started the socio-economic caste census, we had 53 dollar billionaires. By year 2018, Forbes lists you as rank 4 in the world in dollar billionaires. You have 121 dollar billionaires. 121 dollar billionaires on a population, and these 121 individuals, impossible for me to calculate them as a share of population of 1.3 billion. These 121 individuals, their net cumulative net worth equals 22% of India's gross domestic product. It gives a whole new nuance to the word gross. Hmm. 121 individuals account for wealth equivalent to 22% of GDP. Within that 121 individuals, the top 10 corner everything, okay? The others are bit players. Now, there have been years in which China has reported more billionaires. There have been years in which China has and often does. But, you know, our obvious superiority to the Chinese comes from looking at the per capita net worth of the average net worth of the billionaire. So Chinese billionaires' average net worth is about 1.4, 1.3 billion. Ours is 3.75 billion. Our dads are richer than their dads. In 28 years, 29 years, less than 30 years, you've managed to compress and construct inequality and make a virtue of it. We have made a virtue of inequality, competitiveness. You know, this is the way it's to go. Trickle down theory. Theories, policies discredited the world over at a time when the United States was rejecting Reaganism, when Britain had rejected Thatcherism decisively. You clung on to these philosophies and impose them on much poorer people than those in the United States or UK. So the impact had to be proportionally more dramatic. It's at the bottom of a lot of things that, now, okay, so we have the 121 billionaires with 22% of the GDP. Let's look at the other end of the spectrum. You know what, I'm fascinated by the fact that, you know, the top one of the 121 is richer than number 2 and 3 put together. You know, no prizes for guessing who number one is. He is very heavily in the medical and health fields, right? He's got his. So Mukesh Bhai had, he had more than Azim Premji and Sanghvi put together. 2 and 3 together did not equal his wealth. Now, this peculiarity came up in the 2018 report of Forbes. You can find the page, forbesbillionaires.com, online. The peculiarity of his wealth accumulation was that in 12 months of 2017, he added $16.9 billion at the rate of $2 million a day or hour or something. Yeah. In 365 days. That is a phenomenal achievement. I've not seen it in the American billionaires. I have looked, but they've not added at that rate. Imagine, he had 23 point something, he added 16.9. You know, how hard he must have worked to do that. Yeah. Now, or could it be that it has something to do with policy? Could it be that you tweaked your telecom policy to favor one player so that all the others are collapsing? There are shotgun weddings happening between, you know, Vodafone, Idea, they've run out of both. And Docomo, and everybody else is on their knees. Yeah? So you just tweaked the policy a little bit and created inequality within the billionaires. Again, Mumbai is at the forefront, you know, when you come to education and inequality. I live not very far from Bombay Scottish School. It's the only place, even on a terrible bottleneck, where people are allowed double parking and triple parking because they are very, very important individuals. The arrival of the billionaires in the Indian economic scene was dramatically announced by Bombay Scottish's annual day. Normally on their annual day, Bombay Scottish have their, everybody in Bombay Scottish, everybody's parents are super rich, okay? But then the super duper rich came along. So they have a little Shamiana within their annual day to house the millionaires. Then along came the billionaires. And mind you, there was it, even the Times of India went to town reporting this for 5 days. It was right up its subject and alley, right? So how do you have a separate thing for the ultra super duper rich within a Shamiana for the merely super rich? So the Times of India ran 4 or 5 reports on its front page on the outbreak of a bitter class struggle between millionaires and billionaires. Yeah. You can guess who won. Right. So this is your country. Yeah. This is the country. What that kind of inequality, look at the other end of the spectrum. Look at your socioeconomic caste census. In your socioeconomic caste census, what does it tell you about rural India? 75% of rural households. 75% of rural households. How many rural households are there? 179 million rural households in the 2011 census. 75% of 18 crore households, the main breadwinner was taking home less than 5,000 rupees a month. $2 million an hour, less than 5,000 rupees a month, the main breadwinner was taking home. You raise the benchmark to 10,000, then 90% of rural households, the main breadwinner was taking home less than 10,000 rupees. How many people, how many rural households had a breadwinner taking home 10,000 or more? 8%. But then you apply the social to the 8%. 8% is the national average. Take out Dalits and Adivasis, they have less than 4%. Who are the 4%? Mainly government employees. Okay? People working in PWD, highways, clerks, collectorates, government offices. And those are the jobs that you have been steadily shutting down. Jobs in government and public sectors have fallen by more than 2 million since we embarked on our bold, brave new world journey. So the one thing that those groups had, which gave them half the national average in families which had 10,000 or more, that we have steadily gutted. We have completely gutted that. When I saw these figures, I tried doing a mental test. What happens? You know, after all, the promise of capitalism is that hard work will get you anywhere. So I thought, being too ambitious, but I thought, can I also be Mukesh Bhai? I meaning an average Indian, and I'm not an average Indian, I belong to the top 10% like everybody else in this room. Who would we call an average Indian, a common person? I would say you could take the laborer on the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act as your average Indian, as your poor Indian, your common man or common woman, much more likely common woman. Yeah. Can they earn $16.9 billion by working very hard? $16.9 billion, by the way, that year, translated to 1,05,000 crores. So, can someone on the NREGS earn that amount through hard work? Believe me, NREGS is hard work. You try digging 90 cubic feet for your money, you'll figure out how hard the work is. I found to my surprise that you could make 1,05,000 crores. It would take a little time. To be precise, it would take you 1,87,000 years. Yeah. Or you would need, alternatively, 18.7 million laborers to do that in 1 year without Ganesh Puja, Christmas, New Year's Day, nothing. Yeah? 365 days without break. Yeah. And the NR, it could be done on, you could generate that value on the NREGS with 18 million workers. Now, this kind of disparity, this kind of obscene gaps, obviously meant a much, much, it had impacted in everything. It impacted in education. It impacted in the elite schools. It's impacted in, you're looking at it, in the incredible privatization of medical education. You're looking at it in the incredible privatization of all education. Yeah. So education was one sector. The other gigantic sector was health. Yeah. You're living in one of the most privatized health systems in the world. And you're living in a situation where, you know, we are locked on a kind of American journey, the American dream or nightmare actually. 62%, a Harvard study found in 2015-16, that 62% of all individual bankruptcies in the United States came from health expenditure. Now please, it's a myth that only those who didn't have health insurance suffered that bankruptcy. That's not true. In many cases, the kind of insurance plan they had was very much part of the problem, not the solution. Okay? So just having that name of a scheme doesn't solve your problem. In India, the number you've had figures from the PHFI, from the Public Health Foundation of India, from you've had that from corporate organizations giving you, McKinsey and others giving you figures. 2016, 63 million people were estimated to have gone below the poverty line on health expenditures. Now, my own personal experience of this comes from a different angle. I have covered the agrarian crisis of this country from the very late 90s, or certainly I could say from year 2000, and have visited more than 900 households across this country where there have been suicides by farmers. It struck me from the first year in 2000 when we did a major study in Anantapur, Rayalaseema, across 600 suicides. I mean, we didn't visit those 600 households, but across those suicides, what unbelievable health expenditures those families were reporting. Okay? And how did they pay? How did they incur debt? They took loans. That kind of loan for an agricultural laborer or a marginal farmer is not going to come from your banks. It's going to come from a private money lender. Right? So you have this unbelievable accumulation of health expenditure and health debt, and it becomes the fastest route to rural family debt. And it is the second fastest growing component of it, okay, apart from the collapse of agriculture itself and the money you've taken for that. I will never forget that some of us landed up at a hospital in Nallamada block in Anantapur. What happened there? A farmer had tried to commit suicide. His friends and neighbors found him. His wife was able to alert them. Her cries brought them to the home. And you know, he was, you many of you have seen what someone who has consumed pesticide looks like. I don't have to tell you that. They turned a cot upside down, put him on the cot, carried him on their shoulders, tied ropes to the cot, to the legs of the cot. They ran 4 kilometers to the highway, put him in a car, drove him to the nearest hospital, I mean, in a jeep. They put him in a jeep, which they hired, took him to the nearest hospital on the Andhra-Karnataka border, and saved his life. A few days later, when some of us journalists landed up there, yeah, he was abusing his friends and neighbors. He was abusing them. Telugu is a very colorful language for, it's not up there with Punjabi, but it makes a good effort. So we asked him, your family owes these people something. They saved your life. Yeah? Why are you behaving like this with the friends who saved your life? He gave us one look of despair and contempt and told us, you'll find this reported at the time in the Hindu, in the Enadu and elsewhere. He told, his words were, I tried to take my life because I had, you know, he said, I tried to take my life because I had a debt of 50,000. He said, I had a debt of 1 lakh. I had a debt of 1 lakh which I was never going to repay. I do not have the capacity. He said, I built that debt of 1 lakh over 4 years. 4 days in this hospital and I have 52,000 in bills. You should have let me die. 4 days in the hospital was 52,000 rupees. his debt of 1 lakh for which he sought to take his life, that was built over 4 years. I will never forget that scene. I will never forget those words. You know, he simply said it was better to die. It made more sense for his family. Back to Maharashtra and the abolition of famine. The amount of wealth and the amount of in your society, the inequality, is looked at best also through another prism. Maharashtra is in many ways the richest state in the country. There is a greater concentration of wealth in Mumbai than most other cities in the country put together. There is a belt between Mumbai and Vadodara, Surat, which, well, you know, those 121 billionaires of on Forbes, well over half of them have a Bombay address on their passports. Okay. Yet, this is the state, a year after year, has reported thousands of children malnourishment deaths. In 2016, September, October 2016, the Bombay High Court pulled up the government, asked for the chief secretary to be present. He didn't go, by the way. Slammed the government when the data came before it that in the preceding 12 months, 17,000 people in the state had died of how much? 17,000. 17,000 human beings in this state had died of malnourishment related diseases, primarily in the Adivasi areas. Primarily in the Adivasi areas. Okay. You're talking about areas between 70 and 150 kilometers from the richest city in India. That's what you're talking about. Right? How could you allow this to happen? From there, but the point is that you didn't just allow it to happen. You structured your policy and path of development to make this inevitable. And it keeps happening. It happens every year. It happens every year in the country's richest state. So how do you do this? Now, you all know the latest announcement about handing over district hospitals to private management. Yeah. What kind of impact is that going to have? What kind of impact is that going to have on those, on that bottom 30% of your population that has zero assets? What kind of impact is it going to have to them? You're not just encouraging the growth of the private sector, you're handing over what little remains of the public sector to them. This was not an aberration. It was consciously constructed policy that this is the way to go, that this is the thing. The private sector will provide salvation. The Nallamada farmer was one example. You know, so one is this incredible expenditures in household after household of the farm suicides. We found 3 lakh, 4 lakh, because the debt was accumulating since they were unable to repay much smaller amounts. Even if that amount was 50,000, 60,000, they were not able to repay and were ending up with loan amounts of 3 lakh and 5 lakh and stuff like that. And some of them actually had expenditures of... Then comes the phase around 2000 when the corporate hospitals start recruiting a creature in the countryside who must be familiar to all of you, RMP, by which I do not mean registered medical practitioner. Some enterprising soul in Bihar 30 years ago started a thing called rural medical practitioner. So you had the same acronym, RMP, By the way, I am one of the RMPs. I bought it for 560 rupees in Patna. And your contract by which you become a registered rural medical practitioner has a small asterisk, and at the bottom says, all disputes can only be settled in the jurisdiction of the Patna High Court. It required the anguta chap from a sarpanch, which was very easy to get. I mean, I knew 1,000 sarpanches. So this RMP has come into the network, of the corporate hospitals, starting with my home state, then of the undivided Andhra Pradesh. Many of them were recruited into the corporate hold, into the corporate fold, in a way that for every, if I am an RMP and you are the Apollo in Hyderabad, I get 2,500 for every 1 lakh of business that I send your way. This was the rate in 2004. In 2009, I think it was around 3,000 or 3,500. We documented cases where the RMP had drummed up a lot of business for Apollo or whichever the corporate hospital was, and then tragically, the RMP fell ill. He got no discounts. Yeah? He paid 3 lakhs. The guy who was sending business Apollo's way paid 3 lakhs when he fell ill, and it destroyed him. You have the other thing is also how it's not just the medical sector within itself, though that itself is quite a horrible sector to my mind. It's also what you've done in other areas, what you've done in agriculture, what you've done. This country doesn't have, I've been saying this for too many years, it doesn't have a drought. It has a mega water crisis. It has a water crisis, and the only serious discussion taking place at the government level, at the official level, is not on how to solve the water crisis, but how to privatize water. That is what your Niti Aayog chair, leader, CEO, has written 3 articles in Times of India and Hindustan Times about. You call it rational pricing of water. You give it a nice name. Yeah. And I don't have to tell this audience about the links between health and access to water. I don't have to tell you that. Imagine the consequences. A country which has the largest number of people already without access to clean and potable water, imagine the consequences for the health of those people if water is privatized. Imagine the consequences. And imagine the consequences not just for the health of your individuals, but for the health of your country. Water has been at the root of every gigantic political crisis in this country between states and districts, between nation and other nations, which is the biggest political dispute in the south of India, Kaveri, between Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, which is the biggest dispute between Tamil Nadu and Kerala, Mulaperiyar, which is the biggest dispute between Karnataka and Kerala, Kabini River waters, Andhra and Karnataka, Almati Dam. Even today, please note, the discussion going on in the Punjab is bringing back certain memories. A lot of you are too young to have known that even in the Khalistani insurgency, one of the gigantic issues was the sharing of Ravi Bias waters between Punjab, Haryana, and Rajasthan. It took Rajiv Gandhi and Sant Longowal 28 rounds of talks to arrive at a settlement, after which Sant Longowal was assassinated. Now this water crisis is not just between states. It's What is your biggest problem with Pakistan? Baglihar. Your biggest problem with Nepal? Koshi Baraj. Your biggest problem with Bangladesh? Tista Faraka. Right? Your huge problem with, pending problem with China? Brahmaputra. Water is such a gigantically explosive issue. There are wars every day being fought about it. In Kurnool district, in Andhra Pradesh, the head of the family died, a farmer with 1920 acres. This is more recent, I'm talking about say 2010-12. He had five sons. Very easy division of land. Five sons, 20 acres, 4 acres each. Younger brother murdered the eldest brother. Why? Because the fight was over. He took a sickle and killed the guy. What was the fight over? Who gets the 4 acres with the bore wells? That was the fight. That was the dispute. Now your privatization of water, again Maharashtra is the pioneer. Chandrapur was the first township to have private distribution of water. Nagpur has attempted it. The consequences have been devastating for the poorer areas. Water flows upwards from poor to rich. Across the world, you've had governments falling. You've had riots, Johannesburg, Soweto. Or across Latin America, you had governments falling on the water issue. How incredibly connected is that with your health issues? How waterborne diseases, clean water, potable water, how much of India's medical health problems would you be able to solve if you got your water issues sorted out? Yeah. But your policy direction is going to sharpen those water issues, not solve them. The policy direction we have taken is towards the pricing of, towards making people pay. Let's come back again, I say to Maharashtra, Marathwada. Every year, every one of you sees those photographs in the newspaper. Long line of poor women standing in the queue with buckets for hours waiting to take water from the tanker. Has any one of you ever figured out how much she pays for that water? She pays 45 paisa per liter at the start of the season. She's paying 1 rupee per liter at the peak of summer season for water. In the same Marathwada, there are 24 beer and alcohol factories which get that water at 4 paisa per liter. 5 million liters a day. That 4 paisa of water is a huge improvement. For 35 years, it was 1 paisa per liter. Then some brave NGO took them to the courts and won a great victory. It became 4 paisa per liter. Yeah. This is your policy direction. You are burdening the poor beyond breaking point. Nobody can sustain that kind of trouble. Then you bring in your demonetization, you know, don't even go there with all that stuff that you happen. You've had the inequality reflecting very dramatically on the so today you do have a model of health and private care that even the middle classes are unable to cope with. Even sections of the, I always use the word middle classes, I don't believe there is a middle class, one homogeneous middle class in India. The vice chancellor of a university is middle class, his driver who gets 38,000 rupees a month is also middle class. Yeah, but they are different classes. So the middle classes in this country are unable to cope with the kind of medical expenditures that are coming on to them. Look at the, you know, again, as I said, the playing with data, which is a part of our national genius. If you look at, I didn't load that particular. If you look at the NSS rounds, 42nd, the health rounds, 42nd round, 50th round, 52nd round, 61st round, 60th round, and 71st round. After the 60th round, beginning with the 60th round, but dramatically from the 71st round, the questioning and the questions are changed so that we have no way of comparing different data sets. We have no way of comparing across the years. I particularly have in mind the table that I regularly used to do from the earlier rounds on people not seeking medical treatment for purely financial reasons. They have stopped asking that question of financial reasons. They're not asking it anymore. Okay? What did it show earlier in the three rounds prior to 71st round? There is an NSS document on this called On Health Expenditure 2007. What happened? Rural India 1986-87, 1995-96, 2004-05, that is, 40th round, 52nd round, 60th round. Number of people not seeking medical treatment purely for financial reasons. Rural India, 151, by 2004-05, 281, almost doubled. This is not accessibility. This is affordability. Number of people, or then in the third one itself, they start changing it from number of people not seeking medical treatment to episodes not treated. Okay, you're already getting into dangerous territory in comparisons. In urban India, in the same three rounds, the ailments, in urban India, it more than doubled. It goes from 96 to 198 to 204. That means in urban India, the number of people not seeking medical treatment for purely financial reasons more than doubled. And this worried them. So how do you solve the problem? You change the definition. You have changed the definition of medical treatment from medical treatment was defined as treatment undertaken on the advice of a medical professional. Now it is self-medication, everything. So obviously the number of people in this question is going to be completely smashed. Yeah? So you really do not know how many people are not seeking medical treatment today in a way that you can compare to earlier things. But what we do know is that 39% of people who die do not receive any medical attention before their deaths. Nearly 40% of your population. This much we know. Yeah. And the thing is that whether it's in farmers' suicides data, whether it's in your GDP data, we just rejig the figures. You know, like in, they're showing you a big fall in farmers' suicides data. Okay, how do they do that? From year 2014, they split the category of farmers into farmers, tenant farmers, agricultural laborers. This is an entirely dishonest and bogus move. Agricultural laborers were coming under a separate group in self-employed others. Then, when you create this category tenant farmers, you are knowingly committing a crime. You are knowingly committing a fraud at any rate. Why? 95% of tenancies in this country are not recorded. There is no document saying, I am your tenant. There is no such document. So when the person dies, I don't know if any of you has ever witnessed an inquiry into a suicide. When a person dies, the tehsildar or the tehsildar's representative, certainly the constable of that area, the havaldar, will show up at the house. And the first question he will ask the grieving widow or whoever, maybe the grieving widower, Patta dikha, in Maharashtra, Satbara dikha. No tenant farmer is ever going to have a Satbara. No tenant farmer is going to have a document saying, I am a tenant. Because I've given you that, I'm not going to give you a document if I'm the landowner. I'm scared you will sit on my land and not leave it. Right? So what happens to those people who would be in the farmers category? The police have to record them as agricultural laborers. So the number of agricultural laborers committing suicide is going up massively, partly because of tenant farmers and partly because many of those were yesterday's farmers. Millions of farmers have fallen into the ranks of agricultural laborer between 1991 census and 2011 census. The primary census abstract shows you those figures with dramatic clarity. Okay, you will find that the number of farmers is plummeting, but the column of agricultural workers is exploding. In my erstwhile home state or composite state of Andhra Pradesh, the 2011 census showed me number of farmers declined by 1.3 million, number of agricultural laborers went up by 3.4 million. It means not only farmers' livelihoods were collapsing, all allied occupations were also collapsing and people were becoming agricultural laborers. Okay, when you collapse millions of livelihoods, please, do I have to tell you about the impact on public health? Do I have to tell you if you lose your livelihood, you're going to have health problems? You know, and the way this thing has been handled, do you know that hundreds and hundreds of suicides in Andhra Pradesh, when the first major investigation was done across 600 households by Narasimha Reddy of Enadu, ML Narasimha Reddy, and yours truly, the two of us found an incredible number of people registered under others. 60% of all suicides did not come under the regular causes, they came under others. So we went back to the police stations and with some amount of chamchagiri and fraternizing, got those FIRs opened. What was the cause of suicide in 60%? A huge chunk of that 60%, the cause was listed as pottanoppi. Suicide due to acute stomachache. They turned the process on its head. They wrote, I'm not saying this was conspiracy. One fellow did it, then everybody in the bureaucracy follows, right? What was written there? The victim had an unbearable stomachache. Unable to cope with the stomachache, he drank pesticide. The pesticide came from, the stomachache came from drinking the pesticide, damn it. You drink pesticide, I promise you also, you'll have a very bad stomachache. Okay? Guaranteed results. So you had 600 people or so listed as suicide due to stomachache, pottanoppi. Okay? And again, you have come back to that kind of chicanery in 2014 onwards, where you are saying, you know, the suicides in Karnataka fell 62%. Guess what? The others column in Karnataka went up by 245%. Suicides in the six major states accounting for 70% of farmer suicides in this country fell by 50%. The others column for those states goes up by 128%. Okay. Do you know that when we had a major power crisis in Maharashtra in 2000, in the middle of the last decade, they made out a priority list of who all will have electricity at all times. That includes, obviously, defense installations. It includes fire brigade, police installations. Suddenly, they brought in PHCs and mortuaries because people were being rolled in at the rate of one every 8 hours. Okay, so with all the lessons of this, we are still hell bent on privatization, expanding that sector, and it isn't going to help you. So what, you know, what are the as I told you, you have the figures. Something like 63 million Indians fell into poverty as a result of health expenditures in 2016. 2018, it was 55 million, according to the PHFI. Are there something we can do about this? Is there something that can begin to address this. Health, actually what I have been talking about all this time is really that if you're not going to look, if you're going to look at the medical sector only within itself, it's no use. I think one of the at least decent intellectual advances all of us have made in the last 25 years is understanding the importance of the social and economic determinants of health. Not just the social determinants of health. You can also look at that. You can look at the social angle in a number of ways. You can look at the fact that Dalits and Adivasis have a much lower life expectancy than other sections of Indian society. That is also very clear from the data of about 30, 40 years. What are the kind of things you can do about it? What are the kind of steps that you can take about it? I think the starting point would be health as a human right, fundamental, justiciable. That would be a starting point for it. The second would be fixing. I mean, this is not any great discovery of mine. There are lots of people's movements for health in this country, the Janaswastha Abhiyan. I agree with much of what they are calling for, demanding. I add a few things to it from my own. I call for Uruguayan, you know, a tiny country called Uruguay, population 3 million, made a referendum and a constitutional amendment in 2003. And the law was water can never be privately owned in Uruguay. I think we need to do that. And water, not just as a human right, please understand, there are millions of other, 8 million other species on the planet that also are, you know, this kind of, the kind of neoliberal construction of hijacking of water that took place. Water users associations. Who are the non-users? You know, some dry land bacteria. I mean, what is this water users association? James Wolfenson, I was present in Mehboob Nagar when he came to inaugurate the Andhra Pradesh Water Users Association. What happened was that millions of enraged non-users, also known as farmers and laborers, gathered on the highway and chased him. They chased him down the highway. The government of Naidu then rescued him with a helicopter ride. They took him. But since the president of the World Bank had come all the way to inaugurate it, it had to be inaugurated. So they took a plaque and put it up about 2 kilometers into the jungle, where he unveiled the Water Users Association, while about 25,000 non-users had criminal cases of assault, attempt to murder filed against them, and were lodged in what was cutely known as the high-tech jail, which means it had electronic gates. Yeah. So you had, I'm saying, water, its connection to health, its connection to human life and existence. You need to have a basic act against privatization of water, that this is a, you can, once you do that, you then need to prioritize uses of water. I would say that hospitals rank slightly higher than golf courses. Maharashtra had 5 golf courses in 91, today 25. The average, this is the largest water consuming sport in the world. A 19-hole golf course, 1.8 million liters per day, plus gigantic amounts of pesticide to see that the grass is just so. Okay? These are the kind of things. Remember that the Bombay High Court, the one time the media yelled at the Bombay High Court was when it ruled that IPL games should not be held in Maharashtra during the drought because of the amount of use of water. That's the only time I saw the Times of India and Indian Express abuse the Bombay High Court, because advertising revenue comes out of the IPL, right? A ban on water privatization, water is a basic right. Public health public expenditure on health from its pathetic 1% or less to, you know, or thereabouts. you aim for 5%. It's not a great deal. Sri Lanka spends 3 times what you do, Bhutan 2.5 times what you do. A hell of a lot of other countries in your own neighborhood spend a lot more on public health than you do. Yep. Stop the privatization of the public sector hospitals. But one thing over here, and I think that this is actually should be said. The worse the control of the private sector becomes over health, I'm arguing, alas, we have to demand much greater accountability from the public sector. It's not just financial, it's that sections of the public are opting for the private sector because they are unable to cope with the public sector in hospitals. They are unable to cope not just with the medical treatment that they're getting or not getting, but with the behavioral treatment that they are receiving. You know? So I'm saying that you need to expand public health coverage, you need to have a national health, you need to work towards a national health system where there is no user fee, where for poor people, I mean, in fact, you need to work towards universalization of healthcare in this country. So you need that universal health system. You need to halt the privatization of medical education. You need, and this is incredibly important, to tame corporate power in the medical field and in every field. Okay? You need to tame corporate power in this field. Your population today, is the biggest collection of guinea pigs in the world for clinical trials, sometimes illegal, more often immoral. Yeah? You have nothing, no controls over what's going on. It's being encouraged. It goes on all the time. It goes on with the knowledge of the government. It happens in agriculture, not just in medicine, where whether it is BT, GM, you release something, let it spread, and then as a fait accompli, that's how BT cotton came to Maharashtra. As a fait accompli, you say we have no choice but to accept it. So that control over clinical trials and generally over corporate profit. Please know this, that large corporations like Google, Microsoft, have been through your corporate hospitals amassing health, private health data on millions and millions of Indians. Google has said it, that they have got from the hospital system in India so many lakh x-rays, so many million x-rays. The private health data of your public, personal health data of your public, is now in the hands of Google, Microsoft, and others. And we've made the whole process easier through various systems. But here's the point. Not only is it in their hands, the excuse, by the way, and part of the reason is that this is being done for development of AI, artificial intelligence. So we need this data. And please let me tell you that Indian hospitals and doctors are doing similar things in Africa. Okay? Collecting data there on treatment, people given to treatment there. Because there, like here, there are no laws, no ethical protocols that can seriously control what you are doing. So I'm saying health data, the privacy of health data linked to the larger privacy of data in this country is something we need to look at. By the way, I don't have the time, so I won't go into it, but I'm saying I think gender-based violence is also a public health issue and a very important one, which you should not scoff at. I certainly think it's a public health issue. Also, I want to say that the kind of exploitation of medical issues arising from social and economic reasons that is going on is happening with farmers' suicides. There are at least a couple of learned whatever campaigning around the country. Farmers' suicides are entirely the result of depression. Now, this is not the greatest discovery in the world. I have never known anybody to commit suicide in a fit of joy. You know, but the whole mischief is what you understand by depression and what are the roots of that depression. You can go two ways here. You can look at that socio-economic process that has hammered that person into a suicidal mood, or you can medicalize depression and say it's a disease. Though we then have to understand, why is this disease so peculiar to farmers on such a scale? And there is real mischief in here, because the second approach to depression is a boon for pharma, for big pharma. If you're going to treat depression as a purely medical, I will say this in my respect to the medical profession, I will say that I was very impressed. I did the keynote address for the All India Clinical Psychologists Association and All India Clinical Psychiatrists Association in 2010-2011. And I was intrigued why they were inviting me. And they said, the government has asked us to formulate modules for counseling these people, for counseling. And we found, they said, we found, on looking at what the government was asking us to look at, we found that we did not have a clue about the many processes behind the driving the farmers to suicide. I salute those psychologists and psychiatrists for the honesty of saying they didn't know a damn thing about the socio-economic processes pushing. And they recognized that it wasn't a floating virus or disease. They recognized that that depression of the farmer came out of something. It came out of a particular process that ground that person down. So that kind of mischief, I'm saying, please look at, and this is how some of the most disastrous seeds and other things have been marketed in the name of health, better nutrition. Watch out for this. Corporations and health are, you know, antithetical. Because a corporation necessarily functions on the basis of profit. One of the last private practitioners in Orange County in California told me once that he was invited to sit on the board of an health insurance company. And he said that he found, he later wrote about it, that some of the discussions on the thing in the insurance payouts at the on health was a person in hospital, was it cheaper to keep him alive or cheaper to let him die? Yeah? That's why those 62% of health bankruptcies in US, insurance did not solve the problem. The kind of insurance that you had created new dimensions to the problem. So health is a human right. Expanding public systems, halting privatization of healthcare and medical education, no private practice of public sector health professionals, as part of the public system. Working towards a universal health system, you can. But none of this can be done if you are not taking into account those other social and economic processes, the greatest of which is inequality. Not inequality as we knew it 40, 50 years ago, but inequality cynically constructed, ruthlessly engineered. So you are going to, it has a lot to do with your politics also. The kind of inequality you develop, I am never going to treat as an equal somebody, then, you know, I earn 2 million times more than him. There's no way I'm going to respect that person's rights or equality or any such rubbish. Yeah. So it's in fact the health of the individual, health of the public, the health of your democracy is threatened and often determined by the status of equality and inequality in your country. I'm so pleased to see that so many people at meetings are reading out the preamble of the Constitution. I would so like that they also read the directive principles of state policy. Half a dozen of those principles implemented would create a very different system and improve your health. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such an insightful and stimulating talk. I would now like to request Dr. Sunil Pandya, sir, to share his views with us.